Good morning. My name is Dominique Moisy. I'm going to be the moderator of this very early session, which explains why maybe it could have been worse. knowing Thierry, I know he meant it. We're going to have a session on Asia, security in Asia in an historical perspective. And the word historical is very interesting. It can mean really historical, a century-long vision. 110 years ago, there was the famous naval battle of Tsushima, and you have two representatives of Russia and Japan here. But it can also mean, in a more limited sense, 2 years ago, for example, at the World Policy Conference, we were discussing the topic, and there was some kind of obsession. 1913, is Asia on the eve of a terrible catastrophe? Is Asia in the beginning of the 21st century the equivalent of what Europe was in the 20th century? But today, things have not really become better, but they have become so much worse in other parts of the world that suddenly the tension that may exist and that still exists and that in some ways are reinforced in Asia look nearly superficial. To discuss this topic of security in Asia in an historical perspective, we have five participants coming from Korea, India, Japan, Russia, and China. In fact, there is one key actor in terms of Asian security who is not here on the panel, and you may ask why. And this is the United States of America, which is considered as a key. So I will be the Western voice. we'll start alphabetical order by Mr. Kim Hak-joon, who is the president of the Northeast Asian History Foundation and the chairman of the Asian Journalist Association. You have 7 minutes. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Let me start with current geopolitical features of Northeast Asia. Northeast Asia is one and the only sub-region where the world's four major powers, that is the United States, China, Japan, and Russia, uneasily meet and interact, and where their respective interests compete. Northeast Asia is also the region of the world's heaviest concentration of military capability. Three largest nuclear states, that is the United States, China, and Russia, and one semi-nuclear state, Japan, demonstrate their respective military strength in these highly contested strategic crossroads. Northeast Asia is also characterized by the following 2 points. One, the world's largest concentration of divided polities, China and Korea, the two most prominent potential flashpoints. Two, the presence of two vast semi-enclosed seas, causing various maritime disputes, including territorial ones. Taking note of these geopolitical futures of Northeast Asia, let us review recent security trends in this region, which show the mixture of positive and negative elements. What are the positive elements? They are increasing economic interaction as well as independence and partnership for specific interests of issues. Concretely speaking, we now witness rapidly expanding trade among China, Japan, and Korea. In parallel with this trend, the level of economic integration among these three countries continues to grow. At the same time, we also see active negotiations on the FTA and cooperation on ecological problems as well as counterterrorism. Multilateral conferences of the highest political level are also held frequently through the ASEAN Plus 3 Summit, East Asia Summit, EAS, and China-Japan-Korea Trilateral Summit. On the other hand, there exist negative elements either. That is a wide range of security challenges. What we may term it all not quiet on the Eastern Front. Let me suggest five examples in this area. One, competition and rivalry between China and Japan over regional political influence and others. This phenomena has become salient since China's passing over Japan in the GDP in 2010. Two, continuing disputes over maritime territory, including territorial disputes over small islands, maritime boundary delimitation between adjacent and or opposite coastal states, and also, and allocation of marine resources. Recently, China and the United States have suggested different interpretation of a right under the UNCLOS to regulate the activities of foreign military forces in the EEZ, thereby producing other type of maritime disputes. At this point, let me add emerging new types of dispute. One is the installation of the safety zone as formally announced by China under the name of Air Defense Identification Zone, ADIZ. The other is island reclamations in South China Sea. This has raised the serious issue of freedom of navigation. Three, lingering past history and rise of nationalism as evidenced in history distortion by China and Japan. In case of China, it's the so-called Northeast Asia, Northeast History Project has incorporated the ancient period of Korean history, including Goguryeo history, into Chinese history, thereby igniting strong resentment by Koreans towards China. Japan has gone one step further by attempting the distortion and revision of the World War II history. Japan's unreasonable claim over the Dokdo Island, which belongs to the territory of Korea, has infuriated Koreans. Indeed, this island in East Sea has been part of Korea's inherent territory for many centuries. More serious is the undeniable fact that through the revision of laws, Japan has become the country that can execute the war. At present, the Abe administration is even attempting to abrogate the peace clause of the Japanese constitution, which prohibits Japan from executing war. A series of Japan's moves to the war-executing country under the blessing of the Obama administration have become sources of fear and mistrust among not only Northeast Asian countries, but also Southeast Asian countries. China has spearheaded the alarmist movement against Japan's bold moves, which may be interpreted as resurrection of militarism. At this point, let me recall an article published in Quarterly Global Asia, published in 2013. This article warned that the security in Northeast Asia today is like a pressure cooker filled with steam. A pressure cooker has a critical part called a steam valve that allows excess pressure to be released to prevent the appliance from exploding. From this analysis, the writer stressed that efforts have to be made to avoid an explosion. Indeed, there is growing appreciation of the urgency of the security challenges confronting the region. Many experts have pointed out the inadequacy of existing institutions to address the various challenges effectively, arguing that current network of multilateral institutions is only a loose notion of security architecture. Against this background, we should find a new road to security cooperation in Northeast Asia. The Republic of Korea's proposal of November 2013 on the Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperation Initiative, NAPCI, merit serious consideration. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now understand the seating arrangement. We made sure that the Korean, the Japanese, and the Chinese would be separated by Indian and...
By a peaceful Indian.
By Indian and Russian. So that is really the secret meaning of the seating arrangement. We now move to India with M.K. Narayanan, who is a very respected strategic expert. He was the National Security Advisor of India. He's now he was also the former governor of West Bengal. And he asked to speak from the rostrum. This privilege has only been given to India, given the good behavior.
Thank you very much.
Of this country.
Thank you, Mr. Montreal, for inviting me to this very prestigious forum. I consider it a very great honor. So once again, thank you. I would also like to begin by paying my homage to the victims of the unfortunate terrorist attack in Paris a few days ago, and also to express my condolences to the people of France for the tragedy that has befallen them. As we just realized in France, we in Asia see our continent also as a living proof that stability is not the natural state of the global strategic environment. Peace everywhere tends to be highly elusive in our times. Nowhere is this more manifest than at the two ends of Asia. I thought when Dominique mentioned about, I now understand why we had Korea on one side and India in between. I thought he was talking of, we have West Asia and we've got East Asia. I know that this session is supposed to be mainly about East Asia, but I think it behoves us, particularly considering the tragedy that has befallen Europe very recently, to talk of West Asia briefly and how radical movements such as the ISIS have significantly altered the strategic and religious landscape of the region. As we know, in East Asia, we can see all the features of 21st century geopolitics that I think took a large part of yesterday's discussions. The issue of power and legitimacy is very relevant here in East Asia, even as China seeks to expand its maritime claims in the South China and East China Seas, augmented further through aggressive island building, ignoring rule-based international systems. But Dominique, if you would permit me, can I say a few words about the ISIS? I know it is not directly relevant, but I heard with... Yeah. I wanted an extra minute anyway. I heard yesterday's discussions on the Middle East with a great deal of attention, because I want to stress the point that the threat of the ISIS extends well beyond West Asia to many regions of Asia as a whole, and as we have seen, now extends to parts of Europe. What does the ISIS mean to our Muslim youth in India? India is normally seen as an island of peace as far as our Muslims are concerned. They have generally been extremely, integrated with the national mainstream. But I recently had, in the last few months, an opportunity to talk to heads of some of the Muslim seminaries, including some of what I would like to use, say, radicalized Muslim youth. And it is quite frightening to hear what they have to say and how befuddled they seem to be in their perception of the world and the events that are taking place. First, the theology. Of course, this is much the same as the Al-Qaeda, anchored in Saudi Abdul Wahhab's doctrinaire teachings. But I think this is now being laced with a great deal of nihilistic fanaticism, or more associated with the Egyptian Sayyid Qutb. There's a great deal of admiration of what they say puritanical Islam, which embraces exclusionist puritanism. I heard the word, I think it was the Russian delegate yesterday who stressed this point. But together with liberal dose of Salafism, there's a great deal of churn that is taking place, and I think it's important that we understand that. Second, what is the appeal that the ISIS? These youngsters feel that they are fighting for the supremacy of the faith and to redeem the faith. Hence, the degree of violence and brutality that they practice is sort of passed over. Third, the tremendous attraction to the idea of a new caliphate based on Islamic history, redolent with historical and emotive content, it conjures up visions of the 8th century Abbasid caliphate. This has tremendous appeal to Muslims, the young Muslim youth across definitely India. I can't say how much more, but I presume it's true elsewhere also. Fourth, the area of operations. They believe that the ISIS will be able to enlarge their area of influence through the pursuit of such violent means. So there's no hope of peace in the near future. The central themes are hijrah or migration, or buyer allegiance. Sunni Muslims everywhere are being urged to migrate to the Islamic Caliphate to further strengthen it and prepare for future struggles. After consolidation, they will move into the next phase of the struggle. There is a notion that these people have of what is called the Islamic State of Khorasan, which incorporates Syria and Iraq, many areas around the Caspian Sea, some parts of Yemen, Jordan, Lebanon, Iran and Kuwait, Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan, Afghanistan and Pakistan, Northwest India, including Kashmir, and Bangladesh. The ISIS state of Khorasan is essentially a resource-rich region. Fifth, the dialectics. The appeal of the ISIS is directly to the minds and hearts of devout Muslim youth. It successfully utilizes modern communications. It is far keener to transform the social and political terrain it holds rather than on merely holding territory. It practices what can be said in strategic terms, territorial flexibility, enabling it to rationalize any loss of territory without any loss of legitimacy. Setbacks, hence, should not be measured by the usual markers adopted in the case of conventional military campaigns. Finally, the danger. ISIS returnees pose a real threat, a very grave threat. So also stay-at-home ISIS radicals. They provide backup support, coordination, apart from lone wolf attacks. So Mondia Thierry, who sort of anchored yesterday's discussion, I think we need to really discuss how do you deal with an idea and not merely a movement. Coming to East Asia, I know I've sort of expanded too much on that. East Asia, because I think there are enough East Asian speakers anyway. I think while India is neutral in this debate, there is a perception in East Asia that China is the new regional hegemon. Issues of freedom of navigation and freedom of the seas have become critical. As reliance on the blue economy grows, these disputes relating to the freedom of access to sea lanes and oil and gas reserves will intensify still further. There are three aspects, if you'll permit me to speak, about what people in this part of the world see as cause for concern. One is that China seems to be much more aggressive today than it was previously, and its awesome military buildup gives strength to its so-called perceived threat. Two, the determination displayed by Chinese President Xi to pursue his Chinese dream, which encompasses his One Belt, One Road initiative, alongside a revival of the old maritime Silk Route, dwarfing and curtailing the ambitions of every other Asian nation. And three, China's disdain for a viable security structure for Asia on the lines of what Dominique said a few minutes ago, to that which existed in Europe in the previous century. What has this meant? We have a split ASEAN today. We have, in some ways, a divided Asia. When you look at that, a new aspect which causes concern is that China's new integrated national security concept has certain red lines drawn across it. One, China will never compromise its legitimate rights and interests or sacrifice its core national interests. China's sovereignty, security, and developmental interests will not be permitted to be infringed at any cost. Building a strong national defense and powerful armed forces is essential and vital to safeguard China's sovereignty, security, and developmental interests. None of this will be diluted. China would prevent at any cost attempts to instigate a color revolution. Nations in East Asia are hard put to suitably deal with, to use a cricketing term, Beijing's swerve. US shifting guarantees, I know I'm treading on, I'm glad there's no representative from the United States here, though Dominic may claim that. US shifting guarantees to Asia are hardly enough. In the aftermath of Washington's change in emphasis from containment to rebalance in Asia, grave doubts have arisen about US intentions. The US would need to demonstrate strength rather than just resolve to employ power if China is seen to be restrained. Finishing now. Countries in the region are therefore readjusting their priorities. I mean, we have the representative from Japan here, so I shall not dilate, but I think Japan really believes that its security has, or its security risk has worsened overall, and its recent recent defense white paper blames this on Beijing. There are risks which are present here, and therefore we need to be careful. But the tragedy is that Asia is yet to come to terms with the conflicting and competing centers of power in the region. While, as Dominic said a few minutes ago, conflicts have not yet reached a flashpoint, the dangerous portents are becoming even more dangerous. Adjustment among countries in the region are not easy, as we could discern from what was said a few minutes ago. Relations between individual Asian powers and outside powers like the United States, who have been present in the region for long, are becoming harder. China is convinced that every attempt by other countries in the region and beyond to enter into alliances is solely aimed to contain it. Hence, my verdict is that rivalry and distrust will dominate the Asian region and the Asian debate for a very long time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And now we'll move to Japan with Yukio Okamoto, who was former special advisor to the Prime Minister of Japan and who is now the founder and president of Okamoto Associate. Please.
Thank you, Dominique. I'm sorry for my voice because of the cold. I'm sure the cold was not given to me by Mr. Kim, but I'm still suffering. First of all, thank you very much for showing the interest to Asian affairs by this forum. The security and the fate of Asia is an integral part, of course, of the world, to which Europe is one of the key members. I am very appreciative of Dr. Kim's presentation because it laid open in the table what kind of problems we face. Dr. Kim said, Northeast Asia is the area where four out of six largest military nations in terms of the number of soldiers are concentrated. China, Russia, North Korea, and Korea. This is a precarious area. In 1990s, we had thought that Asia was going for stability, and Japan was, of course, ready to take a lead in the bringing about the cohesiveness of the region. But unfortunately, Japanese economic strength receded in comparative terms. There's a very strong nationalism in China and in Korea. I even see, to maybe at the risk of oversimplification, there's an emergence of maritime Asia and continental Asia. Maritime Asia is Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia, Singapore, Australia, and the United States, as against other countries in the continent who are increasingly drawn into the orbit of China. Two months ago, we saw a big military parade of China. This year, specially designed to commemorate the victory over Japanese imperialism. And at the balcony, Mr. Xi Jinping was standing. The next to him was President Putin, and then President Park Geun-hye, and Japanese people were shocked to see the Secretary General of the United Nations, who is purported to run for the Korean election, presidential election. And that was a bit of a symbol for the fissure that is taking place in Asia. Where does India stand in this regard? We are expecting India to play also a stabilizing role in the sandwiched between the problematical seas of South China Sea and Persian Gulf, Sea of Arabia. India's role is very important to secure the freedom of navigations. This is the reason Japan participated in the naval exercise Marabar that was conducted by India and the United States. Now it is a three-country joint exercise. I'm glad Mr. Kim brought about the subject of new security laws by Japan. I think Mr. Abe enjoys a credit in bringing Japan to a more normalcy. Even with that new legislation, Japan will be unable to possess the full-fledged right of collective defense as other countries, including Korea, has. The Constitution is still there, Article 9, which prohibits Japan to engage in a war to settle international disputes. So the peace, the legislation just the new legislation will fortify Japanese position and secure the latitude of Japanese self-defense forces to contribute more to international peace, like engaging in PKO. For instance, Japanese self-defense forces went to Iraq, but the role was limited to only providing waters. SDF could be used only for those peaceful and humanitarian missions. But now, with the revision of the law, Japanese soldiers can go to Iraq and to engage in security of the residents, as other countries, especially European countries, were doing in Iraq. It is a big advancement forward. But please, Mr. Kim, don't forget that Article 9 of the Constitution is there, still untouched, which really is the backbone of Japanese peaceful military policy. Sorry?
I thought Article 9 was amended, no?
No, Article 9 stays intact. Having said that, I want to focus on the issue of reconciliation with our neighbors. This July, I led a delegation of a Japanese company where I sit as a board director to apologize to American prisoners of war. Because the legal claims have been settled by San Francisco Peace Treaty, but there is something much more to it, to cater to the humanitarian emotions. So we went, and you know, it was a touching moment. The president of the American POW Association bowed his head to us, saying that this is the second time he is bowing to a Japanese. First was 70 years ago. He had to bow, otherwise he will get killed. The second is now bowing to show respect to Japanese who came, who had the courage to come to the United States to apologize. I almost wanted to cry. And I had a very, very strong feeling that the apology must be met by forgiveness. And the forgiveness can be only given by the sufferers themselves, the victims themselves, not their children, not their families. So we cannot spend too much time. The president was 95 years old, and while survivors are still there, we really have to come to rapprochement with China and Korea as well. So we are engaging in talking to Chinese laborers who were forcefully brought to Japan during the wartime. And I think there will be an amicable settlement. But there has to be, as I said, forgiveness. Ms. Merkel was in Japan suggesting Japan to follow the model of Europe. But for Japan, there's no France that Germany had. For Japan, I think France was the United States. But the United States cannot really bring China and Korea into reconciliation. There's one more very important thing as far as Japan is concerned, and that is the issue of education. The apathy towards and repentance of war is there. Japanese people are deeply remorseful, and we are pledging, of course, we will never engage ourselves in such atrocious kind of activities. But are we really teaching kids what we did in that vein? I personally feel that we lag behind Germany. We're not conducting the kind of education Germany is giving to children. And that's what we are doing. And we will revise the history curriculum to teach kids more about the history since 1928. When we engaged in our Manchurian war. So it will take time. With China, there is a slight sign of improving the relationship, but with Korea, still not. And when the president of Korea, in her major address, says that the relationship between the aggressor and the victim will not change for 1,000 years, almost tantamount to saying that she would not forgive Japan for 1,000 years, there will be no hope. But we must try. You know, my personal thinking is that the best we could hope for between Japan and Korea is like the relationship that exists between England and Scotland. A sort of a mild sense of a rivalry. But even for the two countries to come to that far, we'll be needing another 50, 70 years, if not 100 years. In the meanwhile, to secure the safety in Northeast Asia and the territorial disputes, Mr. Kim pointed out, I think we are ready to go to the, in fact, we are asking Korea to go to the International Court of Justice. And it is so obvious that we will be the status preservation forces. And I only hope that there will be even a small advancement forward. Now, I think it's the bottom of Japan-Sino-Japan-Korea relationship. But within a year from now, in short-term range, I think there will be a change in the change for the better environment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we move to Russia. Igor Yurgens is the chairman of the management board of the Institute of Contemporary Development and a professor of the Higher School of Economics. Now that you are the key power in the Middle East, how do you look at Asia?
Overextension is a threat, that's for sure. Thank you very much for Dominique. Thank you very much. I don't know. I didn't touch anything. Oh, okay. Does it work now? Okay.
Yeah.
Dominique, thank you very much. Thierry, thank you very much for the invitation. Let me say a few words about our position in Asia. Russia is still in the search of its Asian soul. It found its European soul many years ago, but then it felt offended by our European friends, felt betrayed in the sanctions period, especially after the Ukraine crisis, and rushed to Asia. It announced its Asian pivot. It announced a number of projects which would connect us to Asia. And when you analyze this connection, you see that 70% of this connection is Chinese connection. And we're in a sort of a strange embrace with China because historically, we're not that close, actually. Definitely, our relationship is at the highest level. We don't have any territorial disputes. Mr. Putin and Mr. Xi Jinping talks to each other as friends and so on and so forth. But historically and economically, the rush to Asia dash to China could be as difficult as after the collapse of the Soviet Union, our rush to Europe, which ended up the way it ended up at the moment. So, Russia is still in the search of its Asian soul and of its strategy. Through all previous speeches, you realize that Russia was not mentioned once, but for its fourth largest army in the region. That's all. Our army in Europe is number one army in Europe. And here we have the fourth largest contingent. Apart from the army and some of the hydrocarbon and energy projects, we cannot contribute much to the Asian development. The ideal role of Russia in Asia would be a balancing role, and the role of a mediator between our strategic ally and friend China and the rest of the Asian countries. But to play this role, we have to be more persistent in our Asian strategy, number one, to work it out, first of all. And second, we have to figure out what we want to do with our South Korean friends and with the Japanese Northern Territories. So if we straighten this out, then we're a serious balancing force in Asia, and then we will be respected, and I think our political weight will be used. At the moment, again, we are in limbo, as far as I'm concerned. This pivot to Asia is nothing new. I participated back in 1986 in the commission of Mr. Primakov, who was nominated by the Central Committee of the party to chair the commission on Asian-Pacific Rim, it was called, analysis. Back in 86, they decided, and Central Committee of the party and Politburo, that we have to move serious economic and demographical forces to our Asian part, because I should remind you, Russia is 1/7 of the land mass of the world. It's a huge territory, but we have less than 10% in 2/3 of our territory, which is Asia, less than 10%. And from the day one in mid-80s, there were plans to relocate 5 to 10 million people from European part of Russia to this area, just simply to populate it. You cannot create economic backbone and you cannot create economic potential without people. We didn't manage to do that. Then the collapse of the Soviet Union put an abrupt end to the activities of Mr. Primakov's Commission on Asia-Pacific Rim. We came back to that in the 90s. We started working on the new project of infrastructural development and human relocation. it went nowhere because we had this oil abundance and strategic partnership with NATO, European Union, and so on and so forth. Then, when that went sour, we reminded ourselves that we are Asians and we want to go to Asia with the new force and new initiatives. I hope this time over we will be a little bit more serious and persistent. There are some signs that Russians think seriously about populating our Asian part and improving our economic development there. Vladivostok has announced a free port, visa-free and investment-free. There are a number of serious investments on Sakhalin, LNG being built in around Vladivostok, and so on and so forth. Would that be enough to attract investment from Asia and to start serious economic cooperation, without which we will not be playing any serious role in Asia? It's a big question mark. We do our best at the moment. It's not, again, very strategic. There is a plan announced. We just newly created so-called Eurasian Economic Union. We want it to be some kind of a serious partner to the European Union. It's a newly born baby. And a year passed, and we already announced a new initiative, how to merge this Eurasian Economic Union with economic belt of the new Silk Way of China. That's a gigantic task in itself. We don't know what economic belt of the new Silk Way will be, but we already announced that that will be a synergy between the two integrations. Huge thing, which is not, I think, very well thought through. The main purpose of this big infrastructural development to which China claims it will dedicate a lot of effort and invest $200 billion or something dollars, they say. The main trick is to shorten the way for the Chinese goods to Europe and European goods to China, to Asia, through the territory of Russian Federation. But when you talk to the experts on infrastructure, they say, listen, everything which sails is sailing and it's cheaper. Everything which flies is flying and it's faster. And to move your landmass simply for this infrastructural development, railways, highways, and all of that stuff, very expensive and dubious in terms of economic result. Again, more risks than at the moment immediate results which I can visualize. So from this point of view, I'd say that our turn to Asia, Russian turn to Asia, is inevitable and impossible at the same time. It's a very difficult task which Russia has to face. We started with overextension of Russia. I'm afraid that our involvement in the conflict in Ukraine, now our involvement in the conflict with Syria, if we have this serious involvement into the security and economic development of our Far East, we could overextend ourselves. We simply, honestly, do not understand how that can be done on the intellectual level, and French are very good at conceptualizing things. We didn't conceptualize our Asian pivot. It's, from my point of view, a little superfluous, very needed, because otherwise we will just simply lose our Asian part, either to our Chinese friends or to some other entities. Or we have to think something and to conceptualize something very, very serious. 150 million of our population, less, and 1/7 of the land mass is a great challenge in itself. And if we don't think through where we are we partners with the European Union? Are we partners with very difficult counterparts in Asia? And how that can be instrumentalized? I think that we will face serious problems from in mid to long term. Ideal would be friends with everybody. That's what our famous writer Dostoevsky said in his famous so-called Pushkin speech. To be a real Russian is to be a friend of everybody. But first of all, it's impossible. Second of all, Dostoevsky ended up in being an enemy of the West. starting as a friend of the West. So this is all the contradictions of our contemporary development. I hope that we will calm down. I hope that we will reset with the European Union, NATO, and Western partners. I hope that we will promote the same ideas we promoted in Europe, which is European Comprehensive Security Pact, in Asia. Mr. Medvedev, when he was the president and now prime minister, and he's in ASEAN and European Asia Summit today, he promotes this idea of comprehensive binding security treaty in Asia. Very vague idea from my point of view, because from what we just heard at this podium, to be comprehensive, to be binding, and to be secure is very difficult in Asia this time over. So, bottom line of what I want to say, Russia has to find first its European soul, because if I ask my colleagues here, who are Russians for you, they would say you are Europeans. They will not say you are a part of us, you are Asians. It's difficult to see a Russian face in an Asian context. But we are Asians in two-thirds of our country, and we will try to be loyal partners to our Asian friends. We have to find our peaceful and proper role in Europe. We have to come back with the same ideas to Asia. This balancing role of Russia, which is not the Soviet Union anymore and never will be, would be ideal. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now we move to, last but not least, we move to the giant, China, with Professor Chang Zuling, who is a professor of international economics and an academy member and director of international study at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman. I was suddenly picked up to replace my friend who is a real security specialist. So I try my best to say something. This session is about Asia. Asia is too big, so let me more concentrate on East Asia. And also we do some historical perspective. And East Asia security, I think, experienced Cold War period, as we know. And Cold War period, we had wars. And we have readjustment, moving to relatively a stable regional security order. And then we have a post-Cold War period, and it's a transition. And fortunately, we had no war during this transitional period. And should be a very dangerous period, but until now, we have not. So now for the future, or now from now on, we move to a new period of time. And what kind of a security order we could have? Somebody call it the new Cold War or Hot War. And so what kind we could have for the future? I think that's a great concern. But look at the region now. When we talk about security, we really have a new situation and concept. One is we are living in a globalized time, and the region, whatever differences we have, but the region is highly economically integrated, except North Korea. All the other members are deeply involved or integrated, and which means we have shared common interests together. We have a very strong interest group pressures for the policymakers to continue such kind of trend. And also the security, today we talk about the security, we have a more broad dimensions or contents. Except the national security, we also have more and more that beyond that individual countries. We have a regional security, we have global, we have non-traditional security, especially now we have a new terrorist threat and so on. So that means I think we have to think of security in a broader and new ideas to create rather than following the conventional security thinking. And for the future, I think order, I think the regional security order will not be dominated by the United States, as expected by the U.S., and that's our alliance will dominate regional security. I don't think so. Not dominated by China, and it's not able to do that. And no probably country would welcome such kind of a situation in the future. So that means we need something new, and that we need a new security order. And China called on this, cooperative security, new security concept. And so under this kind of a new framework on architecture, and I think look at the fact, it's not possible for the region to create a totally unilateral one security arrangement. So the regional security should be based on the multi institutions and based on the consultation and self-constraint and on more functional institutional arrangements which make the situation stable. So there will be multi players rather than just one or two key players. So I think probably that is the new future security order in the future in East Asia. Second, let me do some perspective. And the question is ask whether East Asia security can be defended or secured, or East Asia will become more danger or safer. For my perspective, I think yes or no. Yes, that is which I believe as economist by training, and because no country wants to have a war. No country in the region. And China is a rising power, but China, I don't think, has the intention to have a war. And look at, the ASEAN. ASEAN as a group and does not want to have a war. And China, ASEAN, though we have the disputes with some countries, as a general relations, we see, both sides try to keep a stable order and relationship. And China-Japan, that's a question. And whether I think both countries understand the real danger. So they try to constrain, try to manage the risk. So, and Korean Peninsula, that is probably a big question, whether a war will be, emerged or with a sudden accidents or stuff. But I think the difference from the past is that is there are so many big players, they all share the common stand that is prevent from any dangerous actions forcing North Korea or the other sides to have a war on Korean Peninsula. So for the first time, I think all the major players are set on the same table. So I think that's another big difference. So only question probably left for China, the United States, whether the two giants will have a war. So that is why I said no, but maybe, but I think it's the cost is too big. And nobody knows what kind of end. No winner, however, for decision makers from both sides to understand quite well. No winner. So I think the decision makers will prepare for the best to prevent from that happen. There is really risks on how to manage. And there is the terrorist threats, and also there is the emerging new strategic competition between China and the United States. So only thing left for us is how to manage. Aside from this strategic one, I think is one matter we have to consider, that is the difference philosophy or different thinking between the United States and China. And for China's traditional culture, it calls on this kind of harmony and cooperative and consultations. So rather than that is to prepare everything from the first, that is confrontation. And so that is why China calls it kind of a destiny for a community for common destiny. So they try to create, that is a very traditional culture, try to create an environment and architecture which can bring all the parties together, though we have differences. So China has the culture and the philosophy that is put aside the differences, and let's see the opportunities of how to sit together and how to cooperate. So I think whether this kind of traditional concept and philosophy or culture could emerge as a main support for the regional new security arrangement and regional relations, we still to have to work very hard to manage. Because in China's culture, China emphasizes more on this process, and probably the United States emphasizes more on the result. So the process that is need all kinds of environment and all kinds of process of consultations and to prevent from the risk turn to be a danger. Lastly, about China, I think a lot of discussions in previous sessions about China's rising, China's intention, what China intends to do. So the first question is whether China want to replace the United States in the region as a dominant power. I answered already, I don't think so, because China has many things to do, and China's situation is different, and have to manage the very complex transitional and the relations with its all more than 20 neighbors. So it's not possible. Now also the region has changed, because we have so many sub-regional cooperation organizations which China has to deal on the one hand bilateral, and also with the sub-regional organizations, which for most of them China is a part. The second, I think, the question that is the current debate and dispute on South China Sea. It's a very hard, probably I need more time to answer, but I make it very brief.
You don't have it.
Yeah, very brief, but I think China has no intention to dominate or control the whole South China Sea. But we call this historical right, that is nine dashes line. But there is no any Chinese law identify this nine dashes. So it is only a historical issue left by the, Kuomintang government. And so Chinese law make it identify very clearly the islands and belongs to China within the nine dashes. But there is no any definition or identification. So there is no problem of navigation. China never stop any ships and so on. And concerning the reclamation of islands currently, we have to remember that is since China has a claim on all the islands, but China But real situation is most of Ireland is occupied by other neighboring countries. So we have a DOC try to keep the situation. But it is the other countries, they rebuilt the islands for a long time. And they have airports and they have everything there, but China did nothing. So China just started. And the people worried whether China will, you know, use this expanded islands as a military base. I think it's, you know, it's not possible. It's so vulnerable as a military base. It's too far. So that is why China announced to make the islands as a public good. This will be a very important area which could promote China-ASEAN cooperation in the future. We jointly can discuss what kind of public good we can be used in the future. So it's, and it's the United States identify this, the so-called 9 miles of territory, you know, sea territories, because China never announced we request this kind of water territory and so on. So this is still, you know, worrisome for the future rather than, so that is why when U.S. warship passed through this 12 miles, and Chinese official statement is very clear. It's a strategic challenge. It's a threat to our security, and since we have the interests and people there, but never that is breakthrough the China's water territory and so on. So it's still, and I think this is a big question. That is when the rising China is doing something, we put a lot of questions and the bad, the worst expectations for the future, and how to deal with the rising China. So I think the future, the security agenda for the region, and still for two. One, that is how to understand and accept and deal with a rising China. The second, I think China continue to be active, to participate all kinds of initiatives and arrangements, existing sub-regional organizations. And I think that's for the best hope. Thank
you very much.
I think we've had a fascinating discussion about Asia, and each of the speaker emphasis was extraordinarily significant. The Chinese speaker spoke of global architecture, and though the Chinese refuse to speak of a G2, in fact, he spoke as if there was some kind of a G2. The only comparison which you could make with China was, of course, the United States. The Russian speaker spoke about Russian identity, and in particular, Russian identity in Asia. And it was fascinating to hear Igor. When I was listening to him, I had the sentence of Mr. Lukin in the head. You want us to choose Asia, we will choose Asia if you don't want us in Europe. But then clearly that choice to you was not that obvious. The Chinese, the Japanese spoke of repentance in very moving terms. Why can't we be Germans? What makes us different from the German? As if the past, the long past, what happened 70 years ago, was still very present in your soul, in your deepest mind. And in fact, I saw recently a Chinese movie on the massacre of Nanjing in 1937, called The City of Light and of Life and Death, and was all the more moving that the hero of that movie, made by Chinese, was a Japanese, and he was looking through the eyes of the Japanese at what was happening, which was fascinating too. The Indian spoke in universal terms bringing ISIS and what it meant for India and for the region. And the Korean was obviously obsessed with the Korean Peninsula and the part of its relation with Japan on the issue of the past. What emerged from that debate, which confirmed something which I found very preoccupying already yesterday, is this opposition between what I would describe as territorial flexibility and ideological inflexibility. Now you think more and more that territory can be changed. Boundaries can be modified, and at the same time you look at that with an even more fierce ideological approach. And by the end of the day, there is that sense in Asia that your problems are far from being solved. But when you see what's happening in the rest of the world, and in particular in the Middle East, you have a tendency to relativize your difficulties. With one key, maybe exception, it's the perception that the Chinese are more defensive or more aggressive lately, as if there was a balancing between the growth of China inside and the speech and actions of China outside. With these few words, I think I will turn to the room and give you the floor. Yes, please.
Morning. My name is Im Sung-jun. I worked as Korean ambassador in the Korean Foreign Service, deeply involved in the resolution of North Korean WMD issues. Well, I'm now retired. Well, I heard, all the remarks very enlightening and very interesting. Well, I don't want to challenge what Mr. Okamoto said, especially about my president's address and Ban Ki-moon's attending the victory ceremony in China. Well, I'm here to put a question to Chinese panelist Mr. Chang about China's genuine policy toward North Korea. Well, I don't remember, my president really said in her address, Koreans should not forgive, Japanese atrocities for the next 1,000 years. I think most Koreans, really, we have forgiven, what Japanese do for the Korean people during the colonization. But, I think, for a small group of comfort women, I think just a few dozens of women still alive and waiting for the real and genuine apology from your government. Well, we may not forget, what you have done, for some years in the future, but not 1,000 years. Well, I don't think Ban Ki-moon attended a ceremony as a purported or as you mentioned, or a potential candidate for the, Korea's next presidential elections. He never implied, he never said he would come back to Korea as a potential presidential candidate. And he asked the Korean press and the Korean people to leave him alone, to assume his high duties of the UN Secretary General. So, well, I'd like to strain, out those 2 points. And my question is on Chinese policy toward North Korea. We cannot, think of North Korean, Asian security without having our eyes on North Korea, what they are doing now. Well, North Korea has said they developed nuclear issues, nuclear bombs, and I don't know the number of the nuclear arsenal North Korea possesses now, but they clearly have some. And they also developed, I mean, long-distance missiles, ICBMs, which could target, I mean, you know, any point in the United States carrying the nuclear arsenal. Well, you know, since we normalized, I mean, our relations with China for the last, I mean, 50 years, and it's a dramatic bilateral relationship between China and Korea. So in all aspects, I mean, China is very important for South Korea, and especially on in resolving the North Korean dangerous WMD issues. Well, we know, and I know, the official position of China. They always said they would support the peaceful reunification of two Koreas, and they never support, I mean, the developing of WMD on the part of North Korea. But I would like to know, I mean, you know, because there should be some change or even a contingency in the near future, then the defining factor is how China react to that. I mean, whether they would have a military intervention and whether they would cooperate with South Korea and the United States for a soft landing of the contingency. And you are not in the government. I mean, so I know the you know, government line or party line of your country, but what is your real observation and the genuine policy of China toward or vis-a-vis North Korea? Thank you.
Let me take two more questions so that you have time to prepare your answer. Yes, please.
Sir Ellen, École Française Extrême-Orient in Hong Kong. I'd like to thank the panel for offering this historical perspective, which I think is really essential for understanding the way the security equation is changing in Asia as a function of China's rise. And in fact, I think one should step back even further than that and remember that for the last several millennia of Chinese history, China has been a continental power, all of whose threats came from the north. The capitals were first in the northwest and then in the northeast as a function of the shifting threats, and the Great Wall is still standing as a monument to this single-minded preoccupation with putting all of its defensive resources there. And even so, even with this one-minded approach, China was not always able to prevail over those enemies. The only significant maritime venture of China occurred in the early Ming in the 15th century. As you know, it lasted a very short time. It was an exploration into the Indian Ocean. As soon as Admiral Zheng He came back and reported that there was no serious threat there to the Ming dynasty, the fleet was immediately scrapped as an expensive waste of time. The next episode worth mentioning in this context is the British Embassy of Macartney in the end of the 18th century, where Britain essentially offered what we would call today a trade agreement to China with a view to rebalancing the imbalanced trade and also enlarging its scope. This was dismissed as a ridiculous proposition. Half a century later, the British fleet was back and forcibly took Hong Kong and forcibly opened the door. And it's this strategic error of assessment that China had made that costed what China calls today a century of humiliation that followed, the unequal treaties and so forth. This error of assessment. So I think that's important to understand about China's position today. Since Deng Xiaoping's opening in the late 20th century, China has become a global maritime trading power. And it's perhaps not surprising that it now remembers that Britain was a maritime global trading power by being also a global naval power. So I think what we're witnessing now is China becoming something more like the United States, effectively, both a continental and a maritime and naval power, rather than the British model, which was only a maritime power. And I think it's in that context that the idea of the one road, one belt, has all its significance. And it seems to me ambitious, certainly, but coherent. And I think that established powers today who don't recognize this long-term historical development are in danger of, to borrow a phrase from President Obama, of being on the wrong side of history. So this is something which I think we have to understand. Now, one final observation, having said all this, this is in no way to make the apology for any specific territorial claims. I think that's a whole different issue, the legality of these claims, the historical foundedness of these claims. And the way this will be resolved, I think, is globally. This is an issue of the new world power that China has to contemplate and the rest of the world has to contemplate if we want to find a way in which China, as this new power comparable to the United States in the future, how it wants to live with its neighbors and with the rest of the world community. But I think this is a very large, separate subject which one should deal with separately. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Let me take one third question. Yes, please.
Comment. Bilari Kausikan from Singapore. Let me make two very brief observations. First, Professor Kim mentioned in the context of the history issue that Prime Minister Abe's efforts to enable Japan to play a more active security role has evoked, and he used this word, if I heard correctly, fear in Southeast Asia. This is simply not true. All the ASEAN countries, all the Southeast Asian countries, have in fact welcomed a more active role for Japan in Southeast Asia. This is because we have made a political choice to look forward and not backwards in relations with Japan. And if this has not happened in other parts of the broader East Asia region, that is also a matter of political choice. My second observation has to do with Professor Zhang's very eloquent presentation about China's intentions. Now, I agree substantially with what Professor Zhang has said about China's intentions, but that is perhaps the wrong way to conceptualize the issue. China enjoys a good relationship with all the Southeast Asian countries, including those with which she has a very complicated history, like Vietnam. All the Southeast Asian countries want to have the best possible relationship with China. But at the same time, it is a fact that China has aroused anxieties in Southeast Asia. These anxieties are not to be understood in terms of China's intentions, or just China's intentions. In fact, the issue is simpler and more difficult. It is an existential issue. The fact is China is big and we are small. And all of us combined are smaller than China. And small countries who live on the periphery of big countries are always going to feel some degree of anxiety. Big countries have a duty, therefore, to reassure, which China has only partially fulfilled. The issues in the South China Sea contribute to the anxieties, but are not the source of the anxieties. But the use of history to justify these claims does add to the anxieties because China has such a long history, it can be used to justify almost anything. Thank you.
So, the overweight of history. Professor Zhang, you have been challenged. You have the floor. Briefly, we are at the end of our session.
Okay. These meetings, all the questions on China, that's a fact. It's a rising big power. There are so many questions actually answered by itself, not just answered by the outside. Concerning China's policy toward North Korea, many of my South Korean friends believe if China cut off the relations with North Korea, the situation would be better. But I think it's not that simple. because like the nuclear issue, we all understand how and why it's come to the today situation. So I think China will continue to engage North Korea and give the pressure at the same time and work together on the nuclear issues together with the other parties. But with China, for the best hope, and continue to support any kind of change within North Korea. But that's not decided by China, by North Korea. The second observation, that is China continue and probably with more active actions to support any kind of efforts to engage between, of the engagement between North and South. With this new change, that is China make a closer relations with South Korea side, that means we have more cooperation on the Korean Peninsula issue with South Korea. But third observation, I think China will continue, though it's very difficult, continue to work out some result in the future, that is collective security architecture in Northeast Asia, including Korean Peninsula, under six-party talks, all probably are changed or restructured six-party talks. However, with the collective efforts, as I mentioned, for the first time in the long history, all the major powers, players, are sitting on the same table. So that is something more positive. But I think maybe we have better expectations. You see the just recently North Korea agreed to open this new dialogue with the South. And so we have to be very carefully, skillfully manage the situation because the current world is very, very vulnerable. So North Korea feels probably more vulnerable than the others. So I called in some occasions, the other parties have to understand what is the North Korean's concern. And then, you know, we have find a way out. Concerning Singapore's question, I think, yes, we understand. It's how to let, you know, the ASEAN countries to have a better understanding and about China's intentions and policies. Sometimes, you know, we seems the more you explain and the more the worrisome are from the other neighbors. But if you see, but we try to our best. For instance, China-Vietnam, we have a heated debate and even some confrontation on South China Sea, but recent Xi Jinping's visit and the past Vietnamese leaders visit China. So that shows the top leaders, policymakers, try to manage the situation, not to let it go too far. So this is kind of understanding. And also she's visit to Singapore, and they make it very clearly, we want Singapore to play a more active role to mitigate and to teach or China's modernization experience. And China just settled down several 10 million US dollars to ask Singapore to train Chinese bureaucrats to continue. So such a kind of thing, I think we probably need a time because we are in a very important historical long transition of this power relationship in the region. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think, unfortunately, we have overspent our time. You were going to say that it would not take 1,000 years for Korea to forgive Japan. So I'm saying it in your place. I want to thank very much all the participants and the public. We move to the coffee break, being slightly reassured about Asia. Thank you very much.